Hello, everybody, and welcome to the WWE Monday Night Raw review for April 14th, 2014. Here we go, the Raw after WrestleMania. And we kick this night off with a tribute to the Ultimate Warrior, and rightfully so. Now, some may think that the WWE didn't do enough. Some may think the WWE did too much. You know, everybody has a different viewpoint on Ultimate Warrior. If you want to see my tribute video, go ahead and check that out. It's my previous video on this channel where I just talk a little more in-depth about the Warrior situation. I won't dwell on it too much here, but I will say this much. It is one of the most shocking things that's happened in a long time, especially since he was just inducted in the Hall of Fame a couple of days before, unfortunately, passing. Such a shame. I think that the 10-bell salute was very fitting for him, and I think that the tribute video that they put together for him was really great, and I like that they recounted a few of his biggest career moments tonight as well, including when he won the IC belt, when he won the WWF belt, even his SummerSlam steel cage match against Rick Rude. I wish they showed his match with Savage at WrestleMania 7, but we can't get everything we want. And they replayed his promo as well. I think that overall they did a good job of paying tribute to Ultimate Warrior. There are no words and there is no way to truly pay tribute to what he did for the business overall. Now, whether you liked him as a person or not, it's a whole nother question. But overall, as a competitor, I think it's really hard not to like the Ultimate Warrior. Anyway, good tribute tonight, in my opinion, by WWE. Very well done. So we have an Intercontinental Championship tournament going on, where the winner will face Big E, presumably at Extreme Rules. I think that the Intercontinental title tournament is a great thing to have, and I think that it does a lot for the IC belt. I wish they would do it for the US belt, but given the fact that Dean Ambrose still has it, it kind of, you know, would diverge from the great storyline that's developing with the Shield right now. But still, you know what I'm saying, the US belt is the one out of the two mid-card belts. The US belt clearly needs a little more than the IC belt does. But even with that said, I'll say this much. I like this. I like the tournament. I like the concept. I think it's great, and I'm really happy that they're doing it, and they're putting some guys in there who need to be in there. First match was Rob Van Dam against Alberto Del Rio. Good place to throw RVD now that he's back for another probably 3 months or so. Multi-time IC champion against ADR, who has nothing to do. Solid opening match. Good way to kick things off. RVD with the victory. I really, really liked this match. This is probably the second best to the last match. But anyway, we'll get there. So then they go over Daniel Bryan's match with Triple H. It didn't really turn out to be a match. On Raw last week for the belt, turned out to be the Shield and Bryan working together at the end of the day. Bryan was not on this Raw at all. Now, that may be a complaint from some people, but I actually thought this was still a good Raw, even without your world champion on it. Obviously, the only reason why is because he legitimately is on his honeymoon, I believe, after getting married. So, you know, it's sensible. It's a sensible reason to miss the show. I mean, hell, if it was me, I'd do the same thing. So, anyway, Triple H ends up having a little bit of a talk with Batista and Orton, and they say that, you know, he says that if we're on the same page, just like he said last week, if we're on the same page, we're going to be dominant. We're going to take anybody out who gets in our way. Nobody's going to stop us if we are on the same page. But basically, what Orton and Batista say is, we don't really care. We just want to be champion. We're not worried about the Shield and all these other guys. We're just worried about becoming the title holder. So it looks like they're not going to really end up being, you know, all on the same page. But we know better than that. So it ended up turning out to be much different than that. Anyway, Rybacksel versus the Brotherhood was the next matchup. And it's too bad to see the Brotherhood getting, you know, kind of buried far into the ground here. I think that's really a shame. But I'm not really a fan of Rybacksel, so this is a shame to see them lose. Rybacksel's actually won two straight matches. They beat Los Matadores on SmackDown and then beat the Brotherhood here on Raw. Interesting to see that team win two in a row. You never know. Maybe they'll actually get in the tag title, like actual like contendership, like a two-on-two regular tag match, not just be part of a multi-team match. I don't know. I hope not. I don't really like Rybacksel. Never have. They kind of changed up the theme a little bit tonight. I actually like the remix version a little better. I don't know what they're going to do with the Brotherhood. I think their best opportunity to do something big with them was to have them face each other at WrestleMania, and they missed that one, so I don't know what they're going to do with that. Either way, Ryback's beating Brotherhood is a bit of a shame, but it wasn't too bad of a match, and the finish was actually pretty good with Ryback hitting the meat hook when Cody was going for the beautiful disaster. Next, we get Divas action. Paige against Alicia Fox. Paige ends up going over, the new Divas champion. Decent match. Alicia Fox has improved a lot, and Paige is great, and I like this match because it gave Paige a more of an opportunity to show off what she can really do. But you know what? As far as storytelling wise, I have to complain about something. You know, let's be honest here. AJ Lee dropped her title last week, to Paige in an unexpected manner kind of deal. And now this week, she's not even on the show. The person who lost the belt doesn't appear on Raw to cut an angry promo against her, to attack her from behind, to do something about the situation. She flat out isn't on the show, and Paige just beats Alicia Fox. Now, what is that? Where is the storytelling in that? And I know the expectation level is way down for the Divas Division, and I agree, my expectation level is way down for the Divas Division, just like everyone else's is too. I get that. But still, even with that said, why would you not continue on the storyline that you can potentially... I mean, I know that they're going to do this. I know it's going to be Paige and AJ at the pay-per-view and everything. But why not give us a little more build? Oh, they don't have to touch this idea. It's not about them touching. You have to do something with the storyline to develop it more. AJ Lee just lost her belt last week, so she's not on Raw. What makes more sense? Her not being on Raw, or her running down, beating the crap out of Paige, or cutting a promo on her, or this, that, the other, whatever. You know, something to build her up, to build up that title match. Because if you want to make it feel like it's got any relevance at all, that's how you do it. And yeah, I am going to be a nitpicker on that. Come on, storytelling, continuity, it's important stuff. And you can't just drop it, even despite the fact that it's just the Divas Division. Even though I think the Divas Division is important. Not greatly important, but important enough. You know, it doesn't define whether a show is great or not. But, you know, it's too bad. It should have more of a role in that. Because, honestly, women's wrestling isn't bad. A lot of the women that are on the roster right now are not bad. Alicia Fox has improved a lot, and tonight was a really good example of that. But look at her. She's never gets featured. Anyway, tag titles are on the line next as we get into hour number two, the Usos versus Orton and Batista, rematch of last week. Again, ends in a disqualification because the Shield come out and beat the crap out of Orton and Batista. Well, Batista just got hit with the Superman punch, and that was that. Match didn't really do a whole lot. It was only a few minutes long. The Usos were on the receiving end of a beatdown until the Shield came out and beat down Orton and Batista, and that was the end of that. So the Shield get one over there. But at the end of the night, they would certainly not get one over. I'm not sure what they're doing, if they're going to have Usos and Orton and Batista actually have another, like a legit tag title match that ends with a clean finish or not. I don't know what they're doing with that. We'll see what happens. I think it was really just to build the bigger storyline here with the Shield. I don't know. I wouldn't mind if the tag belts were ever involved in that storyline. But anyway, I wouldn't mind if like Orton Batista won the belts and then the Shield and them, you know, that's whole six-man tag that they're looking at, and then you have the tag titles on the line or something. I don't know, just a thought, but it doesn't really matter. Not important enough. I think the Usos can defend him against Ryback, so I don't really want that, but that seems to be where they're going. That's the team that's won the most matches lately. Either way, it still built up the big Extreme Rules match that I can't wait to see. So we get a little bit of a Triple H, Batista, and Orton having a little bit of a... they were collaborating, and it led to greatness at the end of the night. So Paul Heyman ends up coming out and taunting the crowd, going on and on about how Brock Lesnar is the one who conquered the streak, and that as the client of him, he is now legitimized as the greatest manager of all time and all that other good stuff, and that Cesaro is the next guy in line, and basically introduces him the King of Swing. I really like that new nickname for Cesaro. I think it's really good. And then we get Cesaro, who doesn't have a theme song right now. They have him not coming out to anything, which is kind of interesting. It's a little bit different. Reminds me of Vladimir Kozlov when they were doing that with him. We'll see where that all goes with Cesaro. But either way, he's really over, and people like him more as a babyface. I think he's more of a babyface than he is a heel at this point, even though they're trying to push him in that direction because Heyman is clearly still a heel. But I love that he's being managed by Heyman. I think that's great. Anyway, Cesaro versus Mark Henry in the Intercontinental title tournament quarterfinal, and Cesaro goes over with the neutralizer on Henry, another really impressive feat of strength. He hit it on Big Show on SmackDown, and then he hit it on Henry here and actually won this match. That one was thrown out. But, man, the strength of this guy, the consistent ability to be able to lift these big matches is unbelievable. He's a shooter. He's straight out of the old days. It's awesome to watch, and really nice. Good match. I mean, not like a great match, but it did what it had to do, and it told the right kind of story, and the finish was very memorable, so good stuff. I liked it. So then we get the Authority, Stephanie and Triple H, telling Brad Maddox, the Maddox, to tell the Shield that they are in the main event match, but they're not going to tell them who their opponents are. So we'll see where that all goes. Alexander Rusev defeats Xavier Woods next. If you blinked, you missed it. Alexander Rusev wins. Lana's gorgeous. Alexander Rusev wins. I really hope they start giving him something within a few weeks, within 2 weeks from now. I hope he gets a direction instead of just beating what he beat Zack Ryder last week and then Xavier Woods this week. And something new, please. But I am interested, though, to see what they're going to do with this guy. I really like where this could be going, the Bulgarian, you know, that whole piece to the gimmick's cool. I like that he has a valet. He's got a very different kind of body type and appearance, so that's really cool in my opinion, too. I just think that's good. Adam Rose is coming up, too, it looks like, and so is Bo Dallas. And, you know, a couple of new guys coming up, too. I think it's going to be interesting to see where they go with these things. I'm not going to jump to any conclusions and just say, oh, this is going to fail, this is going to be great. Let's just see what happens. I think Alexander Rusev could be the next Tensai, or he could be the next, you know, Umaga, or you know, a big, actually, Umaga turned out all right. But I think Alexander Rusev has unlimited potential with the moveset he has, and his style, his ability. It's really good, and I see a lot for him. I don't know where they're going to, you know, send him as far as direction goes. We'll see. But so far, just getting him on TV, getting him to wrestle matches is a good way to get his career going. So the next Intercontinental title tournament quarterfinal match was Sheamus and Jack Swagger. Now, this wasn't too bad of a match. Somebody pointed this out, and I agreed with it. Jack Swagger, as far as psychology-wise, has never been very good. I mean, you know, you look at a guy like him, he's got the ankle lock submission finish, but yet he doesn't really work it a whole lot beforehand to weaken it up. And then, you know, he has the ankle lock applied, and you say to yourself, man, you know, he's expecting to get a submission out of that. It's actually a pretty valid point. He's also really gassed really fast. He always has been. He just is not one of those guys who honestly has the ability to really last a long time in a match without getting gassed quickly. Not like it's a big deal. He still works all right. He's actually a decent worker. He's not bad at all. As far as when it comes to submission holds and things like that, he's pretty solid. I've always liked Jack Swagger. He just isn't really the best when it comes to the psychological aspect. And obviously his talking has never been wonderful. So that's why he has Zeb Coulter. But Sheamus ends up winning off a bro kick. No surprise there. I don't know where they're going with Jack Swagger. I mean, it seems like they've kind of dropped the Cesaro Swagger thing, which is a shame. I would have liked to have seen Cesaro with Heyman and Coulter with Swagger and had that whole dynamic. You get the managers talking in the promo, and you get these two in a match. I wouldn't have minded these two in the final of the Intercontinental Tournament final. Just be Swagger versus Cesaro. That would have been cool. Either way, I really kind of wanted that feud to be something. I think their matches would be decent. I think having the two managers going at it back and forth would be cool too. Throw the IC title around to build the feud even more. I don't know. That'd be cool. But you know, they always have their favorite. Anyway, Sandow comes out and cuts a nice promo. Damian Sandow's promo was pretty solid tonight. I actually like that they did this with him, but then you have to bring out the Big Show and knock him out. Well, clearly, we have to make sure we still bury him in any way possible. It's really a shame. For whatever reason, this guy's in the doghouse, and it sucks because he's a great, 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 great gimmick, and I think his talking ability is fantastic. I have always enjoyed Damian Sandow's gimmick. As far as in-ring wrestling, he's not some fucking, you know, technician or something, but he's not terrible in the ring. He's okay, and he does what he has to do. It's like a Wade Barrett kind of deal. Like, he doesn't have a million moves, but doesn't need to still work a good match. Very, very clear as day with both of these guys. And Damian Sandow, in my opinion, as a former Money in the Bank winner, and you know, a guy who actually was a relevant mid-carder not that long ago, it's a shame to see him now be on the literally, basically on the bottom of the pile. And at this rate, I really want to see him starting to get something more for himself. I'm not going to lose faith. I mean, I think at some point in time, you know, Damian Sandow, his time will come, maybe. Maybe. They said he was, I mean, you know, all the rumors and the dirt sheets had this whole thing going on about, oh, he's going to get pushed, he's going to get pushed. That was about 6 months ago now, and clearly he's been, just kept getting pushed further and further down, which is a huge shame because, again, a guy with a lot of potential in Damian Sandow, really good talking ability. I've never seen anybody play that intellectual savior type of gimmick better. I mean, other people have been like the genius, Randy Savage's brother, Lonnie Poffo. You know, I mean, he played the genius. I mean, we've had similar gimmicks to this before, but you've never had somebody who's played it this well. No doubt in my freaking mind. And I really think that this guy has untapped potential that, you know, people need to start looking into it. This guy is at least a potential IC champion. I think he's a potential world champion with the way that he carries himself. Very, very good gimmick. You can't just bury it. Hopefully, they eventually don't. Anyway, Bray Wyatt and John Cena had a promo segment next. This was a good segment, too. I mean, some people will say that, you know, oh, John Cena mixing humor in there is not always the best thing. That's John Cena's character. He's always been that way. I mean, are you surprised that he goes to jokes? I love that Wyatt brought up, oh, every time there's a legitimate threat against you, you bring up jokes and try to make it a funny situation when it really isn't. I thought that was a good point. Well, he didn't say when it really isn't, but you know what I mean. This was a good promo segment. It sets up the Extreme Rules match. They're going to be, not Extreme Rules match, but match at Extreme Rules, I should say. It's going to be in a steel cage, and the other two... Rowan and Harper aren't going to be involved. So it's going to be straight up one-on-one, Cena, Wyatt. I'll say this much. If Wyatt doesn't win, it makes no sense. You can't have Wyatt lose at two straight pay-per-views. It makes zero sense at all. And this is why, if it was going to be a one-and-done type of deal, I'm glad it's not. But if it was going to be a one-and-done type of deal, Wyatt would have needed to win at WrestleMania. And having Cena win at WrestleMania is not as bad, in my opinion, if Wyatt's going to go ahead and win in Extreme Rules. But if he doesn't, then I say to myself, man, they are really just fucking... Wyatt over here and just continuing to make Cena, you know, overcome every freaking obstacle. What they should have done, in my opinion, is have Wyatt win at WrestleMania and Cena overcome it at Extreme Rules. So, yes, Cena would still win a match, but a less important match. Instead, Bray Wyatt wins at WrestleMania 30, which is the show that people remember, which is the thing that gets you legitimized. Like it's like a Cesaro winning the Battle Royal, you know? He became a big deal just because of that. I mean, he was already a big enough deal, but I think that really has started to elevate him to a much bigger height. And then the next night, he becomes a Paul Heyman guy. I mean, all of a sudden, Cesaro goes from being like, yeah, real American, he's impressive, this, that, the other, to being a much bigger deal and somebody that you're now noticing a lot more, as the casual fan would, I would assume. I've always liked Cesaro anyway, but, you know, he just had so much added to him these last couple of weeks. And again, the win at WrestleMania is a signature moment for him, and this could have been a signature moment for Bray Wyatt at WrestleMania, and it didn't happen. Either way, I like this promo. Bray's gold on the mic. Cena did a good job. Yeah, he did mixed comedy. I didn't really find it extremely funny. It was nowhere near as funny as the time he made fun of the Nexus and called Heath Slater the chick from Wendy's. That was flat out funny. I mean, I can't say I didn't laugh at any of that. I can't say I didn't like chuckle at least a little bit at this, but I wasn't like, you know, laughing, whereas with the thing with the Nexus, that actually legitimately made me laugh out loud. But I don't think mixing comedy in the promo is that bad, because then Bray brought it back down to serious, and Cena said, if you want serious, you know, you made me serious at WrestleMania, and I proved that I can still beat you even when, you know, you have my head in two different places at once. So it was a really good promo overall, and Bray ended it by saying that this is my world and it belongs to me, and that I will be that we're fighting each other by throwing knives, and eventually one of us is gonna get stuck. Man, the things that this guy comes up with to say are just flat out great. Really good and effective promo. Sets up the Extreme Rules rematch between these two guys. Really looking forward to the match. Good promo. Liked it. Good stuff. Layla and Fandango defeat Emma and Santino Marella. Apparently, Layla is now Fandango's dance partner, and Summer Rae will hopefully get a little more of a push here, and her and Layla maybe will get into it, and Fandango will just watch. And Emma and Santino, yeah, okay. I don't know. as far as that whole dynamic goes, Emma just went from being like, oh, Emma's on TV, to being like, oh yeah, Emma doesn't matter at all. Yay. So Kane and Stephanie are seen backstage, and Stephanie's yelling at him and saying, your job performance has been crap, what the fuck happened to the real Kane? And then all of a sudden you see the mask and this little case, and Kane, you know, gets up, breathes heavy, and then takes the case off and holds the mask and says he'll eviscerate Daniel Bryan. So if you ask me, it looks like they're building toward Bryan versus Kane for the WWE belt at Extreme Rules. Which is an interesting and different match from what I was expecting. I was expecting Triple H versus Bryan, and I actually like this a little bit better, especially with what we ended up getting in the main event. I'll get to that in a moment, but I'm glad to see that Kane will hopefully have one last run with the mask. They shouldn't have unmasked him the first time. They sure as hell shouldn't have done it the second time. But you know what? Given the storyline that they've gone with, the whole corporate thing, I love that they brought the mask back in like that. I thought that was really cool, really effective, and really symbolic as to where Kane is going back to his true self, at least here in character. And I'm going to fight Daniel Bryan in Extreme Rules. I actually would really love that, and I think that would be a good match. Team Hell No facing each other one-on-one for the belt in the main event or semi-main event of Extreme Rules. That sounds really sick to me. Really looking forward to that. The last quarterfinal match was Wade Barrett and Dolph Ziggler, and this one ended up with Wade Barrett getting over. Good match. Easily the best match of the night, in my opinion, in-ring-wise. These two were great with each other. Dolph Ziggler, again, impressing a big time. Great bumping, great selling, as per always. Wade Barrett had a nice performance here. I'm so glad he's wrestling again. He's 3-0 since he started wrestling again, so it's starting to look like they might actually push this guy a little bit. So he will be facing Sheamus, I believe, and then it will be the other two, RVD and Cesaro. That sounds like a solid match. I think Cesaro will probably end up winning this tournament, but it'll probably end up coming down to Cesaro and Sheamus in the final or something like that. Even though I'd much rather see Wade Barrett get in there. But then again, I mean, they usually go for the face versus heel thing, and they're trying to say Cesaro's a heel, even though, in my opinion, Cesaro's more or less a tweener right now. He's getting over, but they're trying to make him a heel, so I wouldn't mind Wade Barrett versus Cesaro. It's two, you know, guys that you wouldn't really be sure who they'd put over, but, I mean, you would imagine Cesaro. I don't really see anybody else winning this. I think Cesaro will actually win the belt from Big E as well, and throw out my prediction now. Anyway, good, really good match. I'm glad Wade Barrett got the win. It sucks that Ziggler is still stuck in, you know, mid-card hell. But, again, you know, I don't really want him being IC champion, so I mean, it's crazy to think that Dolph Ziggler was the world heavyweight champion a year ago at this time, and now he's, you know, trying to qualify for an Intercontinental title match. Whoa. What a shame. Okay, so then we got another video package for Kane with his mask on. That was a pretty good video package. So they're really starting to build up that whole, yeah, Kane's back, which is good. You know, give him one last run with the mask. I heard that his run in WWE might be almost over. So, I mean, within the next year or two, he might be out of there. It might be even less time. I don't know. I don't know how much longer he's signed or whatever. I mean, he wants to get into politics and other things, and that's good for him. Good for him. But I really hope they have one last run with him, and he does fight Bryan at Extreme Rules. I really would look forward to that. So the main event turns out to be an 11-on-3 match. It's the Shield versus a bunch of jobbers, pretty much. I mean, all a bunch of guys like Del Rio, Ryback, Soul, 3MB, some of these other guys that just are, you know, not as important on the card. But they ended up getting their asses kicked pretty much. The better part of the whole ordeal. It really wasn't even that much of a match. It was a little bit of a match, and then ended up in a DQ anyway, because it just became such a huge beatdown once the Shield all did their crazy flips. Suicide dive from Ambrose, and then the big flip over the top from Seth Rollins. Great, great stuff. The Shield did a great job in this. And then we get it, the 11, obviously the numbers game ends up eventually getting you the Shield, and they get their, you know, their asses pretty much handed to them. And then Evolution, the theme song of Evolution, Line in the Sand, hits, and I was just like, wait a minute. unbelievable. The Evolution theme song playing, the three of them coming down, they kick the crap out of the Shield, RKOs, Batista bombs, pedigrees left and right, and believe in evolution, not believe in the Shield. Believe in evolution. And I was just like, freaking ear-to-ear smile on my face. I'm saying to myself, I am so excited right now that Evolution is back and that they're building up those three versus the Shield for Extreme Rules. What a freaking six-man tag that is going to be. My God, that just is fucking awesome. I love it. I love it, man. I love it. And I'm so glad that Evolution is like, at least back for a little while. The fact they're playing their theme song now, like, shit, man, this is good stuff, man. I feel like my childhood was back, you know. It was like, man, is this 2002 again, or like, that's when they were first formed up, but it's like 2004 all over again in my head. Me being a kid still at that point, and man, I can't believe it. Is it just like a nostalgic kind of rush hearing that theme again? Like, all I can think of is 04 when Triple H and Benoit were feuding over the World Heavyweight title, and, Orton was IC champion for a long-ass time, and, oh, man, good old days, good old days. Ugh, God, I miss the Ruthless Aggression era. They were like, such a powerful part of that, too. Monday Night Raw, baby. Anyway, good stuff. Great ending to Monday Night Raw. I thought this was a fucking awesome ending to Raw. Honestly, brought back good memories for me with Evolution. Love that group anyway. And to see them versus the Shield for Extreme Rules, just flat out awesome. Flat out awesome. Great finish. And so overall, I thought this was a throw, basically like a B-Raw. You know, I mean, I think there were some things that were kind of annoying, like, you know, the whole lack of continuity with the Divas title storyline. Other than that, I mean, you know, seeing Sandow get buried more. I love the IC title tournament. Ultimate Warriors tribute was really good. The Wyatt Cena promo was really nice. And the ending was fucking fantastic. Those IC tournament matches were all pretty solid. To see the Brotherhood get beat again was kind of annoying. It does suck to have no WWE World Heavyweight Champion on the show, but it's for an understandable reason. And what was the other thing I was going to say? Oh, yeah, that's stupid Emma and Santino, man. Yeah, no one cares. And, I think this was a pretty good Raw again, you know? I mean, Raw has been, I'd say WWE's product, in my opinion at least, has been pretty good over the last couple of months here. And I think WrestleMania was a huge success. I thought last week's Raw was really good. I thought this week's Raw was pretty solid, too. It wasn't as good as last week's, but I still think it was worthy of a B, B minus, no doubt about it. I'll throw like a B at it, probably. It was still a solid Raw. Good stuff. I enjoyed it. So that's my opinion on Monday Night Raw. Let me know what you guys thought of Raw down below in the comments. Be sure to hit the like button. I always try to give a reason to hit the like button. Hit the like button if you are glad that Evolution is going to be facing the Shield at Extreme Rules, or at least that's what they're, you know, building up to. Just hit like if you think that it's great that Evolution's fucking theme song was playing, man. I was like, oh, in the glory, man, I'll tell you. But anyway. That's all I got, let me know what you guys thought of Raw down below. Be sure to like the video as well, and subscribe up above if you haven't yet, or is it down below? And I don't even know where the hell to subscribe. I always say subscribe up above, even though there is nothing above the video now. I'm thinking like the old days. It's actually still below now. Whatever. I don't fucking remember. Anyway, just subscribe. Whatever the damn button says subscribe, be sure to do it. Other than that, be sure to follow me on Twitter at EMUltraOfficial. I always live tweet during Raw, and that's pretty much it now, Raw and pay-per-views, but I don't really watch Impact, like, when it airs now. I usually watch Impact a day or two later, and that's why you don't see me doing reviews for it as much. But congratulations to Eric Young for being the World Heavyweight Champion. He's a hell of a competitor, deserved it years ago, got crap gimmicks, but has always been a great wrestler, and I'm so happy for him. Anyway, enough of that. That's all I got for this, so thanks as always for taking the time to watch. Hope you enjoyed the review, and until next time, peace out. I'll try to do an NHL first round predictions video Wednesday before the game start, or like as they're starting, whatever. As long as the first game hasn't been finished for the series, I'll still do a series analysis, see if I can do that quick little breakdown each series for a minute or two, but no guarantees on that, but we'll see what happens. That's it, though. Thanks a lot for watching, guys. And until the next time, which should be about middle of the week, and I'll try to do a couple of topic videos. By the way, I was thinking of this new concept, something like a weekend topic video, like talking over a couple of things from this week in wrestling that I may not have covered. I was thinking this past weekend of doing something on Eric Young being the world champion and stuff, but maybe I'll talk more about that this weekend. We'll see. Maybe I'll try to start making like a Saturday type of video and just try to add a little more variety. The Q&A, though, I'll save for that video. Try to do it this weekend or middle of next week. It'll probably be middle of next week, but I'll do my best to get it out there ASAP. Thanks, as always, for taking the time to watch, though, guys. And until next time, peace out.